Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back Hortonworks President Herb Kunitz.
Morning, everyone. Welcome back. It's good to see the crowd back again today. So first thing I want to ask, we said this yesterday. How many of you were there this morning? Anybody in this room? There's one, two, a couple. Yeah, we had about 40 people on the bike ride, so it was good this morning getting everybody out. For those of you who can't tell, it is dark out there at that time. It was 5:30 in the morning, so it was a little dark, but it was a good ride for everybody. We all had a fun time. So welcome to day two as we kick off Hadoop Summit. So I want to try something we didn't do yesterday and just ask the crowd this. So I ask a question and raise your hand for one of three answers, and you do have to pick one of them. Either A, you're brand new to Hadoop and just getting started, B, you have one project underway and already in production, or C, you're well on the path, doing a lot deep into this. You're the black diamond of Hadoop. So if I take those three, green, blue, black, if you guys are skiers out there, how many are the green, just starting out, just kicking off? Raise your hand. Probably about, I'm going to say, 15-20% of the crowd, 20% of the crowd. Okay, how many, one project running in production, right, and doing it? Probably about the same, call it 20%, okay. All right, how about C? You are the ninja of Hadoop. You've got it all figured out. That's still about 20%. I said you had to pick one. It doesn't look like everybody chose, but okay. It sounds like somebody are trying to figure out if they're between one, two, and three. But actually a pretty equal spread, which is interesting as you go across the conferences. In the earlier days, it was many of the people who are very deep in Hadoop, really focused on it, knew it well, right, and we're looking to collect as a group, and now we're starting to see that spread out with a lot of newcomers coming in saying, hey, how do I take advantage of this? What have the others done? What are the opportunities? And that's one reason, you know, we really try to have as many end user presentations as possible so you get to hear from others who are further along the journey in terms of what they're doing. So today, you know, similar to yesterday in terms, we'll have the keynotes in the morning, similar time frame, then go into the community showcase, the abstract, and the other sessions throughout the day. I'll come back to the party at the end here. So one thing a little different today, where yesterday we spent a lot of time focused on what I'd call the transformative nature of Hadoop and how different companies are using it, and then its pervasiveness and how, you know, widespread it is in terms of some larger businesses. Today is going to be focused more on enterprise class, meaning how does Hadoop integrate with many of the core technologies, vendors, and companies that you probably work with already in your data centers and inside of your organizations. What is Hadoop's place within that? And then how do all these other companies work closely with it to integrate it in to their reference architecture as they go to market? So you'll hear from a number of partners, EMC, SAP, and HP, as they talk through that. And then we'll end today with David Epstein. This will be an interesting one. David will be a fun conversation. And what he's going to go through is we all talk about big data and what that means. David's view is really, you can get all this data, but it's how do you find that small difference, that small window that you can go exploit and take advantage of. And think of that in things like sports and other analogies, Moneyball, et cetera, where it's how do you leverage data to take advantage of it? What can you do when you can find that small insight through data discovery of broad sets of data? And he'll put a fun spin on it in terms of how they think of it and applying it to different industries. So otherwise, same today with the community showcase, what's happening out there. Cafe Hadoop. How many here got to stop at Cafe Hadoop yesterday? Okay, pretty good group. I think you get to see some of the tech titans in terms of what they're doing, get to hear how they're thinking of Hadoop, and you get hands-on and get to go play with it while you're sitting with them and sit with the experts. So same thing, wireless, nothing's changed from yesterday, so hopefully everybody has this from yesterday. So I want to get to the party. Party will be fun tonight. So for all of you here, San Pedro Square, if I could emphasize one thing, you have to bring your badge. Otherwise, we'll have all of San Jose, right, hanging out there with us in San Pedro Square. But bring your badge. You get to walk around different bands, different places to eat. It's a lot of fun. And I know last year, a lot of people had a lot of fun with it because it's a free-form environment, good way to interact with all of your peers at the conference, have some good food, some good fun, and listen to some great music. Okay? So with that, what I'd like to do is get this started today and bring up our first speaker. First speaker is CJ Desai, President of Emerging Technologies from EMC. And what he's going to talk about is as a partner, welcome CJ.
Glad to be here.
I'll hand this to you.
Thank you.
We've had a partnership, right? We've worked around many things around Isilon and other technologies and how we integrate that together on an engineering basis, and then also a go-to-market in terms of how we work together with clients. So appreciate you sharing your insights with the craft at
FCJ. Of course.
Thank you.
Thank you, Herb. All right. Appreciate it. So good morning and welcome, everyone. Really pleased to be kicking off day two today, and I see a lot of folks are still coming in. So before I start my session, I would like to kick it off with a brief video.
Down goes the flag, and number one is away. Bumped into the saddle, and off he goes. A very nice start indeed.
Here's McGuinness. Well, what a championship he's having. John McGuinness is absolutely flying. McGuinness has broken the lap record.
McGuinness is
a real natural.
I've almost lost the words.
He's your winner, John McGuinness.
So John McGuinness, the gentleman who was shown, he has won 21 Isle of Man TT competitions. And till yesterday, this is one of the most dangerous, if not the most dangerous, race courses out there. And just this morning, he won the 22nd one. So at EMC, we decided that, hey, let's find out, is it the man, the machine, or the combination of two, why on one of the most dangerous race courses this individual has won so many races. Just to give you an idea of how dangerous this race course is, over its history of this race, there have been 240 deaths. So they are constantly working on improving the safety and making sure that they give proper guidance to people who want to race here. So again, EMC kicked off a project. We put sensors on the man and the machine itself. We did a simulation in Spain, and then we launched it off to the data science community to figure out what was the reason, why does he win so many times, 21 till yesterday, 22 as of this morning, and the results were really, really interesting. And then in the fall, we are going to actually, for the race, we are going to have John wear sensors as well as his machine, the bike, and see what happens in the actual race. So when we did simulation, we announced a competition, it was very well received, and now in the fall, EMC is going to be sponsoring the actual race and figuring out what's the reason behind him winning so many competitions on this most dangerous race course. So with that, EMC's Emerging Technologies Division is focused on solving the infrastructure challenges for these new workloads like Hadoop. So if I have to simplify, the team at EMC is working on figuring out how best we can help so that the adoption of Hadoop is easier for the enterprises. So some of the design principles behind our infrastructure products, or storage products, I would say, is one, scale-out architecture. And the reason scale-out is you should be able to start small and grow as much as you would like. So you don't have to start really big, you don't know how much capacity you are gonna use and what's the data growth rate. Second is built-in analytics, and this is key because EMC is a leader and innovator in storage. We want to make sure that while we are holding the data, you should be able to run analytics workload on top of it. Third is software-defined storage. So EMC has recently, over the past few years, moved more towards the software direction, whether it's scale-out blocks, scale-out files, scale-out object. We want to make sure that the value is in the software, and similar to Hadoop, you can run this on commodity hardware. I would say the open source and taking inspiration from this community right here, just last month we announced that our storage automation as well as provisioning software, we open sourced it, made it available for the first time on GitHub on Friday, and you will see from EMC, more and more products will be open source, again, similar principle as Hadoop, in trying to leverage community's expertise to make our products better. And the last point on next generation flash, this one is important because as the analytics workload move from batch to real time, how can we harness the power of flash so that you can run workloads at a much faster rate when you want real-time data? So all of you know this really well. It was, I think, 2004 when the original white paper on MapReduce was published. Then the team at Yahoo took it, and what a phenomenal evolution over the last 10 years or so. I mean, I saw the attendance numbers here, 4,000 batches, 300 more to come. Definitely huge growth rate in this community right here. And the evolution over figuring out Hadoop for a variety of use cases, as you saw yesterday, but our focus and EMC's focus is usually enterprise infrastructure. And what we see is for enterprises that are trying to adopt Hadoop, how can we make it simpler for you? The challenges you have in enterprise infrastructure where you have data silos, you have a variety of tools, you have existing investment in the infrastructure, you have to work with sourcing, lines of business asking you different things. So how can we enable so that it makes it easier for you to deploy Hadoop? Now, when we look at the ecosystem that has evolved and multiple Hadoop distributions, whether you know Hortonworks, Cloudera, and others, or Pivotal, which is part of EMC family, you know, pretty good about open source strategy on the distributions and then the tools that are on top of it. And we want to make sure, again, that we provide infrastructure as this community contributes to the evolution of this great technology platform. We want to make sure that we make it easier for you while you face the challenges with the typical enterprise IT infrastructure and silos. So, from our standpoint, because EMC is an infrastructure provider or the storage provider, you know, what are some of the challenges for mass market adoption of Hadoop? So first is, once you want to make Hadoop as a truly enterprise-class platform, you need enterprise-grade reliability. Simple things like making sure it's highly available, you can have backup, replication, security, your compliance requirement, whether you are a pharmaceutical or financial services organization, you have to make sure that this platform can support just the basics of what enterprises typically look for. The second is process the data in place. So if you look at the 90s evolution on data warehouses and others and you know variety of databases, the data actually moved to the tools. Data moved to the tools, and then people figured out, hey, how can I run reports and you know have my data warehouse that can scale to whatever the terabytes or petabytes of data back then. What we are trying to also make sure is that data is in place, and rather than data moving to the tools should move to the data. Second is, you know, when I look at RDBMS evolution, and yes, you know, there are questions about, hey, where are we on the maturity curve on Hadoop platform side? The multiple distribution and tool set is just gonna be a reality, right? There will be multiple distributions, there will be certain tool sets, and as the industry evolves, we are going to see that a few of these tool sets become very prevalent, both from a market share and adoption standpoint. So when I look at multiple distribution is going to be a reality, then how can we ensure that at least the data set on which these distributions and tool sets sit on top of is one as much as possible? I mean, that would be ideal, because you can run multiple distributions on a single data set. That's where we would like to go. But right now, it is still happening where you are creating multiple siloed infrastructure. Diversity of storage, similar to distributions and use cases, our goal is also from an adoption of Hadoop standpoint, give you the flexibility on the storage, right? So if you require file access, or whether you have billions of files and you want object as the underlying infrastructure, or whether you want a specific for real-time analytics, very, very fast underlying infrastructure, diversity of storage is key here. based on the use case you're going after. And then the last point is around multi-tenancy. So as from an enterprise standpoint, when I go and speak to customers, they feel comfortable. Hey, they've gone with a particular distribution. They are using a few tool sets on top of it. But multi-tenancy for lower end of the enterprise where you can run Hadoop as a service is a key feature that will enable the mass market adoption of Hadoop. Now, this is one thing that we are very focused on at EMC is what we'll call multi-protocol data lake for analytics. So one is to enable this adoption, we want to process the data that's in place. We want to support multiple protocol when you are writing specifically to your data, as in to your infrastructure, when you want to modify or when you want to read from that specific infrastructure, you should be able to do that. And we want to provide as many protocol support as possible so you are not creating siloed infrastructure. So again, polyglot storage is key here that you have a single common data set and you can use various languages to either read from it or modify it. We also want to make sure that if you have a single data set, then you can be secure, and all the policies around data management, audits, and others for your regulatory compliance is still there. And then from reliability standpoint, we have to make sure that this data is available in a 24/7 type of format. There is no downtime as you add more data, ingest more data. I could easily see you use Splunk for ingesting data and then use Hadoop for further analysis. So one of the goals is multi-protocol data lake will enable, rather than having multiple silos, you can just use one data lake, use multiple protocols to access data, and because the underlying data is still integral in the data lake, you can use multiple distributions on top of it. So right model for right use case, of course, we know the history of Hadoop, and DAS was the primary mechanism. We understand it, we completely endorse it, that when you want to use multiple distributions, you take data out of whichever the source it is and ingest and have models running, whether it's your favorite distribution, whether it's Horton, Splunk, and so on. On the shared model, like I said, if you use the data lake as a foundation, you have a single copy, then it allows you to use multiple distributions on top. So depending on your use case, it really varies whether you want to just go with DAS and start small or whether you want to use shared storage, okay? So from our standpoint, the way I look at it is, if you want to have multiple distribution, don't know your 2 to 3 year strategy on where you are going with your Hadoop distribution and analytics tool set, maybe the one on left is better. If you have at least a lot of data already in the shared storage and you want to have multiple protocols supported, then maybe the right side is better. And this is really, really important when you get budget approved for Hadoop and the infrastructure that is lying below it, that you can get a good TCO, all the enterprise class features, security that you expect, and most importantly, performance as well. The second thing I would say is, from a real-time analytics standpoint, going from descriptive to predictive, or from batch to real-time, when I look at, say, in financial services, you want to run Monte Carlo types of simulation, you have fraud detection algorithms, you have security analytics types of application, where the time is of essence, the latency required is in microseconds, you're not talking milliseconds, and the performance required from the infrastructure should keep up. If my credit card is compromised, I don't want my credit card company to tell me after 12 to 24 hours. I would like to know that information within minutes. That protects me as a consumer and also protects the enterprise, as in the financial services organization, from writing off a huge loss. So we are doing a lot of innovation in Flash to ensure that as we move from batch to real time, we provide you the technology so you can basically run analytics really fast. So EMC has three analytics storage platforms. We are a big believer in having rather some overlap than creating a gap for you. We want to make sure that if you already have a lot of data in our Isilon scale-out NAS clusters, then you can use Isilon, and like I said, with multi-protocol support, run analytics or multiple distributions on top of it. We also have a cloud-scale object technology called ECS, and what ECS allows you to do, geo-level replication. I'm sure some of you may say today, why would I do geo-replicate? I have a DAS environment, and I'll figure this out. But if you want geo-level replication, single global namespace, performance for billions of files, small or large, then object is the right technology, and we have a product for that. And last but not least is DSSD. This is an acquisition that we did about a year ago. It's based right here locally in the Bay Area. And this is a rack scale flash. And what this allows you to do is microseconds latency, real-time analytics. We are working with some of the ecosystem partners here today to ensure that we support multiple distribution so you can run reports like that. A report that could take 12 to 24 hours to run on a DAS type of environment could run in a few minutes. Some queries for which you sit very long time where the business unit is asking that, hey, give us the performance data for our sales, marketing, whatever the case might be. Our goal is to enable so that you can run these reports really, really fast. So I would say that on a shared storage, and the term is very specific here, on a shared storage, 800 of you today in a variety of environments are using Isilon for in-place analytics. ECS, which is the recently launched products, allows you to have cloud scale. And I will use one example, a financial services organization that had credit card transactions in mainframe. They were copying that over 16 different data sets, tried to run various processing on it. We, using our Isilon technology, were able to leverage the infrastructure of Isilon, put all the data out there. They decided whatever they want to do it from a processing standpoint. It went from 50 racks in the data center to only 5 racks. It also allowed them to use whatever tools they wanted, whether it's distribution or tools on top of it, to leverage the particular platform, as in Hadoop platform here, and enabled security, government, where they have peace of mind because it's a financial services organization. So we are seeing examples where shared storage does make sense. And again, there is no right model, shared versus DAS, but depending on the use case, you can do that. And in the closing comments, you can visit us at booth D3. We have a couple of sessions today in the afternoon. But just to reiterate the message from this deck is, at EMC, we are very committed to providing you the storage infrastructure, whether you want to do batch or real-time analytics, and our teams are working really, really hard to make sure that you can easily deploy and have a high performance and reliability at enterprise class level for your Hadoop platform. Thank you very much for your time. Herb, back to you.
Yep. Thank you, CJ. So I appreciate the conversation, everything we're doing together.
Yeah.
Right. I know working with the whole EMC Federation, everything, as you mentioned, on shared storage, all the work in the Open Data Platform Initiative, all the work with Pivotal, right, on certifying what happens with Hawk on HDP.
And the last example we used was ODP-based.
Exactly. So, yes. Exactly. Right. Well, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye. All right. So now I have the pleasure of introducing Scott Now. So for some of you who may know this, I first had the opportunity to meet Scott. Scott was the president of Teradata Labs, had been there for many years driving the direction of Teradata as an enterprise data warehouse and the architecture and how it fit in the enterprise. Scott's chosen to continue on with his journey in the data architecture, and now join Hortonworks as CTO and to work with Hadoop and to start to see where does Hadoop take its place as that next generation data architecture inside of the enterprise. Scott joined recently, so this is, I'd say, the first time in a public stage and coming out and talking about the customer journey and how he sees Hadoop playing in that customer journey and what it means. We'll also have Russell Full-Smith join from TrueCar, who give his perspective on what they've done as they've built their architecture out on Hadoop. So with that, Scott, come on out. And welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you. Here you go.
Thanks.
Well, it's really great to be back here on stage at Hadoop Summit for my fourth time. And it's amazing just to watch the transformation and what's happened in the whole industry and how all of these new technologies that we're delivering are starting to really yield that customer value, that customer benefit that we've been talking about for so long. So what I'm going to talk about this morning for the few minutes that we have together is a little bit about what's driving our strategy and why I think we're at the right place at the right time with the right tools. But I'm going to focus also on some of those benefits that have been yielded from the Hadoop ecosystem and the Hadoop stack. So core to the strategy and why I think this is so transformative for the industry is we call Open Enterprise Hadoop. Open means that we can now tap into the innovations and the ideas from around the world, from a limitless developer base. And open also implies not only lots of new ideas, lots of new brain cells kind of trying to solve those new big data problems, but it's also that community of openness where there's some friendly competition and there's a drive to innovate and a drive to innovate faster. And that openness is one of the biggest transformative things that I see in the Hadoop space. Enterprise means you got to collect all of that and turn it into something that is trusted. That is trusted, that can be used, that can be deployed, that can be redeployed, that can really yield value in an enterprise. And that's really the core of our strategy, right? To build the best, the most breakthrough analytics, right? And those analytics have to be innovative, they have to be new, they have to show us something that we didn't intuitively know. And that is happening today. But to be relevant, they also need to be trusted, right? Have to be able to believe it, have to be able to take action in your business based on the analytic because you trust it and you're trusting your business, you're trusting your customer relationships to those analytics. And so that depends on this enterprise notion that I talked about that includes governance, security, and operations. All of those things are really important. So let's look at some of the transformational analytics that are happening in the industry today with some, you know, real customers, right? So web trends, the challenges are not unique. Yesterday in the keynotes and in the breakout sessions, we all heard about the challenges that are out there. There's a lot of data. It's hard to consume. It can be expensive to consume. It can be complicated. It can be hard to be agile in this space. And in this machine learning with Spark solution, what Web Trends was able to do is reduce cost for data storage, deploy in the cloud to, again, make deployment easier and more seamless, and to process a whole lot more stuff, 10 billion events a day, 20 milliseconds or so per event. So this is really good. And this is helping, obviously, to drive extreme business benefit for their company. We have a stream analytics use case from Symantec, who I think also is presenting here at the conference today. Again, the challenges, expensive, can't keep all of the data, right? Latency is a problem, and that's been solved. And they're now processing 105 million log events per minute. And, you know, the bad guys are out there trying to break into all of our systems, and so being able to be this agile and respond with all of the data and all of the analytic power that that data provides is extremely important. And processing time was reduced to a time that's actually helpful for driving value in the business. Bell Helicopters, when we talk about sensor data and understanding what's happening in very expensive equipment and being able to proactively manage that equipment to reduce downtime, to provide a better customer experience, and to combine all of the data from different siloed parts of the business into one place where the data can be analyzed. And that data can turn into analytics, and those analytics can really provide proactive recommendations, a better customer experience, and better total cost, okay? So, and finally, getting a 360-degree view of the customer. And this is one of the more common use cases here. We're referencing a very large retailer who has used a combination of solutions, including traditional databases as well as a Hadoop stack, to really create that 360 degree view of a retail customer. And this is extremely important, right? As consumers, we're all becoming more and more demanding. We expect, if you looked at yesterday's keynote speech, we expect to be treated like royalty. And if we're not, the cost is extreme because we will go somewhere else. And so being able to create a 360-degree view of a retail customer in high definition and be correct is extremely important. And combining different silos of data, different kinds of data, being able to analyze that data, right? And in this use case, our customer has saved millions of dollars in storage costs, streamlined their inventory, and as a side benefit, actually got increased revenue by being able to be better and more intelligent about pricing, and actually drove the top line as well as the bottom line with these solutions. All of the solutions that reference in these customer examples were all done with earlier versions of Hortonworks Data Platform. Earlier this week, we announced Hortonworks Data Platform 2.3. Lots of information in our booth on the expo floor, talking about the different features and functions. But let me just give you kind of a high-level view of the things that are in here that we think will continue to help accelerate adoption and value creation from the overall Hadoop stack. Broke it down into really three easy categories. Make it easier for users to use this stuff. Make consumption easier. That's really good. Make it more secure and easy to govern, and support it better. These are really, truly the enterprise-grade features that we've added into HDP, where we combine the open, the innovation, all the new algorithms, all the new analytics, and put it through the enterprise-grade test to make it easier to consume and more trusted. So in the user experience, there really are two kinds of users of the system, right? There's the operational aspect of a user of HDP, and we've made it easier for operations, easier to set up and install, customizable dashboards for the operational staff so they can actually track cluster health and cluster utilization over time, and much easier provisioning for more agile analytic delivery and deployment. Again, all centered around Ambari and a graphical user interface that makes it easier for the operator. For developers, we've also created some really important ease-of-use capabilities, including visualization for SQL. Again, making it easier to kind of interact and see what's going on. Improvements to machine learning and Apache Spark on Yarn to make processing easier to implement and a little bit more efficient. And some fault tolerance and some other enterprise enhancements for streaming applications to make them more dependable. So the user experience, a large amount of investment, and a large piece of HDP 2.3. Security and governance, also very important as part of being trusted. We've created a whole bunch of things that help the security administrator, including encryption of data at rest, which is obviously really important in today's world. Security and privacy and all of the data that we're collecting, being able to be confident that only those that have a need to access and a need to know can have it. Encryption of data at rest, as well as easier deployment of authorization and security access, and scalable metadata services to provide the ability to actually audit what's going on. Data governance, keeping track of what data you have, where it is, how it got there, really, really important. So we've created, you know, three basic concepts inside of here. Transparent governance standards for data governance and the data steward. Data landscapes to make it easy to reproduce relevant data landscapes for additional applications and users. And again, enhancements to metadata services to really understand what's out there and what's in. The final piece of enterprise grade is really around support. Once these things are built and deployed, they've got to be supported to be trusted. They become dependent on by the business. So in addition to the support, the traditional support, including customer portal and knowledge base, on-demand training, and access to support analysts, we've actually added Hortonworks SmartSense to be a little bit more proactive in terms of the overall support and the trusted nature of the cluster. And SmartSense provides dashboards and recommendations on how to improve the overall operations and management
of your system. And there's an example of one of those dashboards here. And again, with in here, there are a few proactive recommendations that are actually on the screen. So we think that in addition to continuing to invest in optimized case resolution and providing that real-time support that you need, this proactive smart sense adds another facet to the supportability and truly to the enterprise-grade capabilities of HDP and HDP 2.3. So I rushed through a bunch of things. I think a couple of key concepts. We're in the right place at the right time. Open enterprise Hadoop is a really important concept. We're actually starting to see those values that we knew were there once all the data got together and smart people got to look at the data. And we think it's important to continue to invest in making those analytics both innovative and trusted to find that next tier of enterprise value. At this point, though, I'm going to stop talking, and I'm going to turn it over to the presenter you really want to hear from, one of our customers who's actually gone and delivered value from the Hadoop ecosystem and the Hadoop stack. So please help me welcome Russ to the stage.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
Appreciate it. I'm going to warn you all, I got great news right before I came on. They killed the presentation clock and said I could go as long as I could want, as I wanted. So be warned, I may deviate from the slides. I'm the head of our data platform at TrueCar, which can mean a lot of things to people. But basically, if there's data that comes into the company and needs to go out, it'll flow through the technology that my team delivers. I don't know if everybody has used TrueCar. I assume not, because I'm not seeing it in the sales numbers. So I encourage everyone, if you're in the market or you're about to be in the market, please go use TrueCar. What we are is a marketplace that helps people buy and sell cars. We've been around for about 10 years. We went public last year. And the whole premise is very, very simple and right in line with everything that everybody here is doing. It's about giving data to everybody who's operating in the marketplace. We believe that truth and transparency is just a better way to do business. And so what I'm going to present to you is our true story about our usage of Hadoop and our growth in that. So here's, I guess, I'm probably revealing the money slide too early in this presentation, but I wanted to get it out so you could understand it. A couple of years ago, about 15 of us from my team and a couple other teams in TrueCar came out here to Hadoop Summit, and I distinctly remember the chuckles I got when I put in the budget to have everybody fly up here, spend all this money at hotels and restaurants and learn all this Hadoop stuff, and they're like, Russ, who are you kidding? We're only using about 20 terabytes of data. We can shove that in traditional warehouses, which we were doing. You know, we had some 5 data warehouses with 206 different databases in them. And everybody was like, but really, we can just clean some of that out and move on, right? Like, this Hadoop thing, is this really going to stick around? And I was adamant with a couple of my other tech leaders. I said, no, you don't see where this is going. As TrueCar grows and it becomes more mobile and more real-time at the dealership, the data is going to demand that we think completely differently around how we collect, analyze, and distribute the data. Lo and behold, we jumped headfirst into it with Hortonworks in July of 2013. I and my team, you know, the executives have empowered me and said, Russ, you spend what you need to spend to give us capabilities faster. So I did that and immediately had my pal John provision as much hardware as we could possibly order. And so we threw a couple petabytes of nodes up, which we were able to get the economics. And I just want to lay to rest anybody who's still thinking economics are an issue. We're able to achieve 23 cents per gig on our storage, which just means we don't have to think about it anymore. So we got going, and it was like, okay, great. We have all this hardware. We have all this latent capability, but we have no applications. And we don't have any applications because we don't have any developers that are great at Hadoop, which probably many of you in this room are, it may be in the back of your heads that that's the real challenge. This is a brand new technology. There's all sorts of capabilities, and it's really hard sometimes. And I said, you know what? It's not a problem. It's not a problem. And of course, the chuckles were still there. I said, we're just going to train everybody. We're going to hire and we're going to train. And so we started doing that. And we started with one Hadoop developer that was actually pretty good. And then it was 2. And then it was 3. And today we have over 25 what I would consider experts in, in our Hadoop infrastructure, and we're extremely effective at recruiting new ones now, to the point where I don't have to put up the "we're hiring" slide anymore. We're actually getting inbound requests for people that want to play with our data and play with our Hadoop infrastructure. Well, to add to all of this, we desired to go public last year, and we had a very accelerated pace for going public, which puts a lot of pressure on when you're the guy who says, you know, in the middle of all this, I'm going to go ahead and transform our entire data infrastructure while we're attempting to do all the things you need to do to go public, while you're growing at a 30% year-over-year clip on revenue and other metrics, we're just going to go ahead and continue to do this crazy transformation. Lo and behold, it works. We go public. And we start launching real applications on Hadoop. And what I mean by real applications, and the Hortonworks guys sometimes hate when I say this, especially the sales guy. And I think many of them will remember when they were talking with me early on in our partnership, I said, I don't do POCs, because POCs are crap in the end. They end up giving you sort of a half application that may tell you something, but usually doesn't. And I mean that in terms of actual big data. Because the real applications escape the scale of your existing systems very quickly. So there's really no way for you to say, is this related to this? Are these metrics compared? They're not. And I wanted to do something that was just going to very clearly establish value. And so we started rebuilding what is one of our most important systems, which is our vehicle intelligence system. And what that is, that's a system that takes in all of the vehicle records that are laying out there in the world, everything that you would want to know about a car, we have to bring in constantly throughout the day as the data on those cars are changing, new and used cars, the prices on those cars, everything. And we have to constantly be synthesizing it and spitting it out into the various applications. It's an incredibly business rule intensive system, which is also not something you typically launch with in Hadoop, at least in what I've seen. You typically do the more aggregate analytic thing, not some big rule-driven, gotta be perfect, get all the data right. But we did it. And we launched what we call the 2.0 version in August of last year. And it was one of those transformational things, because we went from being able to spit out all this vehicle intelligence once a day on the core vehicles we cared about, to being able to do that every 30 minutes across the entire set of vehicles that we're bringing in, as our awareness of vehicles was also growing. I could go into many, many other applications that we've deployed over, you know, we're just constantly churning these out every 3 months, and it's starting to get to the really fun stuff with Spark and the machine learning and some of the stuff I'll talk about in a few minutes. But, you know, just take a look at some of the metrics that I put up there, and they don't represent the whole story, but I'm hoping they give you a sense of the growth and the real work that we're doing there. And on the last part, you can see just how much data that we're bringing in. By no means do we have the most data of anybody on the planet, but I wanted to give everybody here who's just getting started or is in like their second application just a sense, you know, of how quickly this stuff actually does grow. So what's the point? You know, what is underlying, what's driving what we're doing? And so I've showed this slide. Usually I put a giant brain on it, but for the sake of the slide being readable, I didn't put the brain on it. But the idea is to be the brain of the industry. And what that means, if I decompose that, we need to accurately identify assets in the marketplace. That can be a vehicle, that can be a consumer, that can be a loan, that could be a lease, that could be an insurance policy. And why I say identification is super important, you can't be wrong in automotive. The transaction is way too complicated. So if you're wrong, you lose the transaction. If you're wrong, you get in trouble. You can't be wrong. So we have to accurately identify what we're dealing with all of the time. Then the premise of TrueCar that I just talked to you about was make sure you can assess the value. And what I mean, I didn't use price or anything like that, because value is what's important. We need to establish prices and then show context for why those prices are what they are. If you've seen the TrueCar curve, use the mobile app, and you've seen the analytics on this stuff, The goal for our consumer and our dealers and the auto manufacturers is to make sure people understand why the market is currently pricing where the market is. And again, that relies on knowing what you're dealing with and then constantly finding out new data points that might tell us more about the value. Third, and you know, this is a theme that you've heard out of lots of folks here, which is we need to be able to predict and prescribe who, what, when, how much, et cetera. And so if you look at the stuff in the middle, I try and say things in a simple and straightforward way, especially so that I can like constantly keep the developers on track. Our goal is to acquire everything, literally every piece of data we can in the automotive industry, synthesize it within 15 minutes. Now, that may not sound like real time, but if any of you are familiar with automotive data, you've gone to a dealership, you've went through a transaction, you can understand and appreciate what it would mean to actually be able to synthesize any given data source within 15 minutes. There are data sources, yes, I can consume in real time, such as user behavior on the web, people clicking on things, et cetera. But there are other data sources in an industry like automotive that move at different timescales and have different fidelity during those timescales. So I'm proposing something that I believe is pretty radical for this industry in technology. And then on the bottom end, it very much is a mirror to the top part of that, which is we need to make everything easily accessible. And what that means isn't we aggregate everything into a nice EDW, we put some reports on it, everybody gets an email about it, it's the same thing every day, blah, 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 blah. No, we are much more moving to what I would consider a contextually aware intelligent search engine. I think there's lots of big giant tech companies that are also realizing the fact that consumer demand is dictating, and user interfaces on phones and different devices dictating that there will not be a set UI. There will not be a time for you to perfectly create a linear experience and a linear data set that will deliver perfectly for every person. Instead, you kind of have to open it up and let people search through your data and forage for what they need. And in a lot of cases, in the case of automotive transactions, you also need to be able to learn from that foraging and push people the contextually relevant information, you know, at the time that you think they need it. So the technologies that we've been deploying, obviously HDP, we've gone through a couple, you can tell from the last couple of years, a couple upgrade cycles. So super excited that they're working on more and more automated rolling upgrade stuff. We've deployed Spark into some of our most mission-critical algorithms on the back end to do our transaction matching and things like that. We've deployed Elasticsearch to great effect, which has had a similar transformational effect on what we do and how we deliver the information. And then more recently, we're developing advanced multidimensional real-time visualizations using the Unity engine and some processing. And if you want to go where hopefully your heads are going, very much so exploring Minority Report-like experiences within the TrueCar data sets. And it's not fiction. Like, if you want to see some of this, I'm happy to show you, you know, if you catch me on the floor out there. So to give you some numbers on this, this is what we do at TrueCar. And you saw it in the first slide. Our data has grown 24x in the last 12 months. That comes from, you know, over 12,000 third-party data feeds that come in every day. Obviously, we have a bunch of event data that we also generate to the tune of 65 billion data points that we're processing through this data platform. We have to put valuations and price reports on 200 billion possible new car combinations and all the options and things that you can put on a car. We've processed over 710 million vehicle images, which I hope is surprising to some people that you wouldn't think that is something a company like TrueCar has to do. But actually, you know, we've had dealers tell us, and I kind of laughed at it first when I heard it, and then I thought, that's kind of true. If there's no vehicle image, the car doesn't exist. And so images are actually an important data set that TrueCar deals with, both just in being able to show people what vehicles are out there, but there's a ton of intelligence embedded in those images. And then we've, you know, over a 10-year period, we've seen over 20 million car buyers go through our platform. So that's no small data set. And then, you know, and Scott had mentioned it, the open enterprise. You know, is that just a buzzword? It's not. And we've kind of lived it even before Hortonworks started to use the phrasing. Because our vision with that data platform was to make sure that we got out of our own way. Put all the data somewhere. Make sure everybody who's supposed to get at it can get at it easily. The stuff that I was saying about giving search away to the consumers is also what we give to our internal people. We eat our own dog food. Internally, you need to be able to search those same data sets and learn from those and decide how you want to compose those and get those out to the world. So, you know, and again, in terms of number, We had a 72x improvement on our inventory processing, even while adding more business rules, more data, et cetera. And that's only accelerating as we get better and better with the technology and as the platform, the Hadoop platform itself, continues to improve. We had a 24x improvement in image processing, which we'll take you through the technology. We'll open up and show you that technology later in a talk that me and one of my great engineers, Anil, will be giving later today. And I'm really excited because he'll go pretty deep into what we did there. You know, we had a 20x improvement in the number of internal Hadoop experts. We had a 12x improvement for things like Clickstream. So obviously, that's good stuff. And it doesn't matter where we've deployed Hadoop and Hadoop-related technologies. We've seen these kind of improvements. And when you combine that with the economics I talk about, I mean, I don't have a budget that I sit there and worry about. No, what I worry about is the speed at which I can continue to drive features that drive those kind of numbers. It's a competitive advantage that TrueCar did what we did, which is we jumped into this technology long before this room was completely filled with people that are just getting started. It's important in the auto industry to lead the way, even if it's super risky. What that's led to, you know, in qualitative terms, developer productivity. Yes, early on it was hard because people had to learn new things and some of the things were still early and immature. But over time, the key was giving people access to the data, because if the developers can understand the data and see where the value is, they'll develop better solutions upstream for processing that data. Data science capabilities, those are obvious. I think some people think that the data science, the key to data science is, you know, having really cool stats models and really advanced, like, computer software things that make you visualize. No, the key thing is speed. Because if you, whatever models you're doing, and I went to the Redpoint talk on machine learning, and he kind of hinted at it, which was, you need to be able to test your theories as fast as possible. Almost every machine learning technique, its bottleneck becomes the speed at which you can train something. So I focused almost exclusively on speed, getting information processed faster so that everybody can experiment even more and more. And no experiment is going to tell us the answer. There's going to be answers that get pulled back, and we have to rethink it, just constantly redoing it. That's the key to our improvements in data science. And then, of course, the recruiting engagement. And I can't stress that enough. If I had underestimated one thing in my own hubris, thinking I can talk people into things, it was really making sure that we could hire people. It's super competitive out there. And we took it instead, the way we were going to do it is be a little risky and say, we will train you. And we know these skills are going to enable you to go on in your career and make lots of money doing whatever you love. But we're willing to take that risk that if we continue to be fast and inventive, you'll want to continue working here. And I think if you talk to any of our engineers in my group, we've had extremely low turnover in the last 2 years, which to me is a metric that I really, really care about. So where is this all going? And again, this isn't fiction. That's why I call this the future present. Because a lot of times we'll say, oh, the future. And I'm always like, when is the future going to get here? Like, the example I always use, it's like Dippin' Dots has been the ice cream of the future for like 30 years. And we're not eating Dippin' Dots every day. So I don't want to keep saying the future. I'm saying it's here. It's actually here. So here on the screen, I have some visuals to represent what I'm going to say. But I want to make sure you understand it. We have already started deploying what I call market simulations. And what these are to us is that we give dealers, OEMs, ourselves, ways to turn dials, turn knobs on various facets of the data. Some things we know very well, some things that are on the edge. When you turn those dials, our data platform goes to work and it says, hey, if somebody decides to drop an incentive in this region, in this marketplace, on this vehicle, what's going to happen to the rest of the market? Then another guy does the same thing over here and over here, and you start letting these simulations interact with each other. And all they are is millions and millions of experiments. But it's important that we run those experiments and have the user base run those experiments and have the dealers run those experiments, because we learn through those experiments about things that are likely to happen should all these dials actually in the real world be turned. Well, what that does is that helps people prescribe their own strategies and deploy those strategies. Both, I'm talking from the auto manufacturers as well as the dealers. So what that helps TrueCar understand is, where is this dynamic marketplace moving? And it's interesting, because is there any way to do a long-range prediction on something like the auto marketplace? Absolutely not. But is there a way to get a two-day advantage, you know, against your competitor on where that market might be going? Absolutely. And now those 2 days can mean a big difference when you're talking at the scale of the automotive industry. So beyond those simulations, which obviously some of those simulations are deployed purely as analytic things, but ultimately those simulations get deployed through our mobile experience where users are out in the real world. And over half of our users now are using mobile. They're going to the dealership. We understand where they are. We've geofenced them. We can deliver information based on where this marketplace is going at the right time. We've already deployed this product in a little way, and I encourage you to go use it and experience it. And we're right now in kind of the version 1.0 of it, but it's going to get pretty advanced. And then on the furthest side there with all the pretty maps, we're going to give all the data away. We believe so much in the truth and transparency and what it can do to a marketplace to make it efficient that we're going to expose all of this through beautiful interfaces, through search interfaces to all of our partners, all of the auto manufacturers, all of the dealers, all of you, and you will be able to plug into our data platform and explore it to your heart's content. Because at the end of the day, we just believe the more everybody's informed about the automotive industry at every aspect of it, the more that they will actually transact and the better experience that they will actually have. And again, this is not the future. I encourage everybody, go experience this on our service. Yes, because I would like all of you to use the service, but also I want you to understand that this is not in the back office. This is stuff, our platform is powering what you see out there, and it's doing a lot of business. The one last thing I wanted to mention, because Scott kind of got into it, and I think if I had a little bit of a technical challenge that people gave me was, you know, is Hadoop going to work in the enterprise? As if that's somehow, like, I wasn't doing enterprise-y things with TrueCar. Which is really interesting. You know, so we talk about data governance and master data management and security. Of course. It could do it 2, 3, 4 years ago. It just was harder than it is going to be in something like HTTP 2.3, which is great. But for me, that was never a roadblock. I hate those kind of questions and those concerns where it's like, is this ready for the enterprise? I'm like, what's worse? That you can't actually do things at this scale, but they're safe and they're enterprise-y. Or that you can actually achieve these and then back build for those enterprise features that you need to put on the board. So I just want to encourage everybody, if you're in that headspace, like this, you can do really cool shit. And at the end of the day, I think that's the most important thing that you can take away from what I'm telling you. So I want to thank you all for letting me tell the story. I'm happy to go through it in more detail. And I want to thank Hortonworks. They've been great partners for us. So thank you all.
Russell, thank you. Appreciate it. So when we went through in the beginning, we said, who's just starting with Hadoop? Who's got their first project? And who's a ninja? Thank you.
Thank you.
So great insights, right, in terms of you think about it. And for somebody like TrueCar, right, they've built their business around Hadoop. That is what's providing the data as they look to say, how do I provide a service back to the market in terms of what they do? So great to have them share what they're doing there. So now I have the pleasure of bringing up Quentin Clark. So Quentin is the CTO of SAP. And what he's going to spend some time walking through is think about all the signals and everything we've just been talking and much of what you just saw with Russell in terms of all the signals that you can process and the new data in terms of what you can do. Now how do you start to share that with the decades of transactional information that have run businesses and say, how do I start to find other patterns? So Quentin, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Here you go.
Thank you. As a recently hired new CTO at SAP, I've had the opportunity to step back and take a look at our industry, take a look at enterprise customers, where businesses are going. And it's very clear that the role of information, the role of data, the role of Hadoop is becoming the most important impact on the digitization across every industry, across every business. Imagine that we live in a world now where Uber and Airbnb are the largest ground transportation companies, the largest vacation rental companies. They don't own any assets, right? They don't own cars, they don't own vehicles, they don't own properties. How's that possible? Well, data is at the heart of this. The data that's coming from the telemetry, from the systems, from social, they understand what is going on with their users' experiences because of their ability to embrace deeply data. This digitization of our industries, of the world, is in the forefront of the minds of every one of our customers. Imagine, if you will, what's going to happen. And you can imagine that in any walk of life, basically in any role in the industry, we're going to see this massive transformation occurring over that's been happening and that will come over the next decade. If you look in retail, you know, we talk about the new signals that come because I can now deploy systems that let me understand exactly where customers are in a retail shop. And we talk about big data there in terms of being able to do analytics on the history of what's purchased, what's trending, being able to predict better what products you're going to need, optimizing supply chain. But what's coming next? What comes next is being able to do this in real time as we marry together information that comes out of sensors in retail with point-of-sale data, with data about the effectiveness of sales associates and stores. We can change how the store operates on an hour-to-hour and day-to-day basis, not just look at optimization of supply chain, these kinds of things. Look at oil and gas. We talk a lot about the instrumentation coming out of the machines that run things like oil rigs and drills and refineries. And we talk about doing predictive maintenance. But what's really next? It's really about optimization of downtime for maintenance, right? It's about in real time being able to understand if you're going to take a machine and take it offline, what else should you also do at that same time? What are the predictions of coming failures, and how do you integrate that into overall optimization model for that system as a whole? You look in healthcare. We talk a lot about patient records and new sources of information, but really what we need to be striving to do is making every doctor smarter in real time, make every physician smarter in the moment, so that they can be augmented with the information that they need without having to chase down every journal and every patient record and every artifact in the world themselves. How is the machine going to make them smarter in real time? All of this is about this digital disruption. It is about the digitization that's happening across the entire industry. So SAP, why are we here? Decades of data. It's not until these new signals get married together with the line of business signals that business meaning is made from this information. We can't solve for optimization of who's on the retail floor as sales associates because they're best at selling certain products until you've married into the line of business data. We can't solve for ensuring that we are preparing doctors for their very best ability to treat patients unless we have access to their schedules and to patient histories and to the line of business data that exists in the medical industry. We can't do the optimization on a financial basis of what it means to run and optimize maintenance schedules without understanding the business impact and the financials of that company. It is literally where the line of business data marries together with the new signals that the context and the meaning is made for the business, for changing that business, and for digitizing that whole industry. SAP HANA is a data platform that allows us to embrace Hadoop and allows us to marry that line of business data and that perspective in with all the new signals that are coming. When I got to SAP, I spent a lot of time trying to understand HANA deeply. And what I found was interesting. It is not a traditional RDBMS. It's a different category of database. It's a transaction processing analytics database where it challenged the assumptions that were created 30 years ago when we separated as industry the transactional from the data warehousing analytics into two different product spaces. HANA brings them back together. By starting from scratch and building systems anew, we're able to build a data platform that really remarries and allows applications to run and build over data that is happening in reality, in real time, as well as the data that's been historical, and running analytics on the transactional data itself. But line of business data isn't the only data. So we're deeply embracing Hadoop to allow us to have the best ability to go and to manage all the different signals that are now impacting every business across every industry. And we have many projects and many needs to do this. We age data from the line of business systems out into Hadoop. We're taking business documents and records out of our ERP system, and we're aging them into Hadoop, but providing through HANA a unified and consistent programming interface so that applications can still be built that can still do analytics across all time. That's driving us to integrate management of Hadoop into the management of HANA. In our HANA cockpit, our management tools for HANA, we're integrating Ambari deeply so that our customers have a single landscape that they can manage. We're building real-time intelligence scenarios into the overall solution. We have predictive analytics, we have streaming analytics, all that can happen across Hadoop and the line of business data in a unified way to allow customers that are building these new solutions to do things in real time. New applications are being developed. SAP has a very strong organization that does co-innovation with our customers. We literally have development working side by side on customer projects, driving forward what's going to change in their industry, what's going to change for them as customers as they embrace new data. And a lot of those projects obviously are centering around how they're going to leverage Hadoop for these new signals. A big piece of this, of course, is IoT. And really where IoT and line of business data collide, that business meaning is made. The IoT scenarios across our landscape are pushing us to embed Hadoop more deeply into our solutions. And finally, a lot of what we've talked about here at this conference in the last few days has been about the enterprise readiness and adoption of Hadoop. A big piece of this is this Atlas project, where data governance becomes an important component of how customers are going to wrangle and understand where they are with these data assets. We have an incredible partnership with Hortonworks Shaping. We're doing co-engineering with them, so that our work that we're doing across HANA, integrating HANA and Hadoop together, is being supported by a world-class organization and development team. We're going to be leveraging Hortonworks as our distribution as we go to customers and solve solutions on-prem, as well as building out our infrastructure for the cloud. HANA Cloud Platform will be our solution for how we extend the business applications and integrate across our line of business apps that are best of breed, things like Concur and Fieldglass and Ariba, as well as the traditional ERP solutions, S4HANA, S4HANA Cloud Edition. We're involved in the Data Governance Project. In particular, when you look at the global interest and deployment of Hadoop, governance of information becomes an incredibly important topic. And finally, we're working on a project in Spark. With Spark, we're trying to accelerate its readiness for in terms of performance and scale by taking the expertise that we have in in-memory systems and helping the Spark effort move forward. But we're also bringing the business data context and awareness into Spark. Not all data shape the same. In the business context, you have things like hierarchies, and you have to have an understanding of what the semantics of dates mean relative to physical boundaries. And we're bringing that semantic understanding of data into the Spark ecosystem. One of the things I have the pleasure of doing in my job role is talking to customers. Yesterday, it was aerospace and financials, and after I'm done here today, I head off to an energy company that's here in the Bay Area. And this conversation around the digitization of every industry and what's going to change and how it's challenging the core even of what they are is forefront on the minds of all of our customers, you know, across the whole industry, across every industry. Across boardrooms, in boardrooms across the world, the questions being asked, are they going to be the victims or the leaders of this digitization of their industries? Thank you.
Thank you, Quentin. Appreciate it. As you look at that and you start to say all the data that you can start to marry, all that information, the transactions, how you can start to put that together and what that means, and the patterns of insight that you can start to get. You know, we even heard it on the first day as we talked about IoT, right, as GE and others were up and talking about that. Say it's a whole set of new signals that you can marry to that transactional data and get new insights that you couldn't do before. And if you can start to provide that in a real-time fashion, what you do with HANA, what you do with Spark, and what you do with other ways, it can start to give insights that weren't possible before and start to give them in a time frame that you weren't able to do before. So now what I'd like to do is I'd like to welcome up Walt McGuire from HP. He's the chief field technologist for the big data business. What he's going to talk about is, you think about the journey to a data lake, right, and how that starts to progress. How does HP look at that, and where do they fit within that, and how do they work within that area? So Walt, thank you very much.
Thank you, Herb.
Pleasure. Here you go.
Thank you. So first, I'm glad to be here today. This has grown into a huge event. I've been doing business in the Bay Area for many years, and I've watched Hadoop appear from nowhere and become quite common in organizations. What I'd like to talk about over the next 15 minutes or so today is an artifact we call the data lake. For those of you who don't know, the data lake is a relatively young concept, born out of the fact that enterprises 10, 15 years ago were throwing away a lot of data. For every byte they brought in and put in their, say, data warehouse, they would throw away a megabyte or a gigabyte. The result is these businesses needed a place to put this data. Hadoop has been invaluable for that. It's given them a place to ingest it, a place to store it. The challenge, several years ago, I talked to a CIO here in the Bay Area who told me, Walt, I have 3 petabytes of data in Hadoop today, and I think 100 terabytes of that data is worth a lot of money to my business. The problem is I don't know which 100 terabytes those are. The tools are too hard to use. I can't afford the staff. I can't scale my analytic pipeline without scaling my staff accordingly, and I need to change the equation. This story I've heard again and again across different organizations, and this has led to some less than flattering references to the data lake. Here in the Valley today, I've heard it called the data prison. I've heard it called the data barn, the data dump, and the data swamp. So what I'd like to talk about today is how we're addressing this at HP. We formed a big data group, and we built a platform called Haven. And we've ported that to Hadoop, among other things, and I'm going to talk about that. So first, where do we usually start? When a business undertakes a data lake project, they often have visions like this. The waters are going to be crystal clear, it's going to be blue and transparent, and I'll be able to just peer into the data lake and see things I could never see before. Unfortunately, this is what they often get. They get murky water. They say, the tools aren't right. I can't hire the people fast enough. The system doesn't handle mixed workloads. I'm afraid I can't secure it. I don't know what's in there because I can't see it. So, what drives the data lake? What are we trying to do with all that data? Why are they putting it in there in the first place? Sometimes it's a very tactical question. Sometimes they want to run a query. I need to, I parked all this data in Hadoop for the very first time. What I need to do is I need to perform some exploration. I need to understand, what is it? What kind of data is it? What do I do with it? How can I start to model it? How can I turn it into a predictive model or an explanatory model for my enterprise? So it's, in some cases, very tactical. I just need to begin by running a query. Now, if we step back from that to a decision maker, what we hear is, I need to change the equation. So more than once, I've talked to leaders in organizations who have told me, what I need to do is I need to increase my analytic pipeline by an order of magnitude, by 10x. But I cannot hire 10x the people, and I cannot create 10x the infrastructure. So what it amounts to is productivity. We have to change the equation. And in some cases, this amounts to making people's job easier at the organization level. It amounts to making the organization more effective. At the end of the day, if a company is prepared to spend millions of dollars on a data lake, and that's not unusual, they're going to need to add unique value for the business. That's what it adds up to. So as much as we get excited about queries, I'm a technologist, I'm a lifelong database guy, at the end of the day, the business isn't going to spend money on it if we can't do something for the business. So at HP, we put a lot of time and effort into developing tools and technologies for organizations to turn this, these muddy waters, into this. The ecosystem you expect, the insights you want to get, the things your business needs in order to do things more effectively. So let's talk specifically about Haven for Hadoop. The idea here is we want to make the data lake business ready. That revolves around 3 basic themes. Theme number 1, something I call data transparency. What this means, in essence, is that an analyst can sit at a console, fire up a tool, and they can get at the data regardless of where it is, regardless of how it's stored, and regardless of what format the data might be. Specifically, things like writing a query, and who cares if it's stored in ORC format or Parquet format? Let's query that too. Why not push down predicates into those environments so I can optimize performance on those things? But also, I get a lot of questions around, the developers love JSONs because it's arbitrary. I can change it whenever I want. The problem is database people hate it. It makes their heads explode because we don't know the schema. So why not make Haven for Hadoop auto-schematize your data? Dump your JSONs in, run a procedure, it creates a view, and it's immediately queryable with various features for optimizing and making it go fast. In this way, we can create the transparency into the format, so you don't need to worry about it, you don't need to care. But more generally, Hadoop is a very rich ecosystem, so integrating with HCatalog, so that that way we can peer into the metadata, and even if it's not necessarily optimal out the gate, we can get at it, we can create the transparency. More mundane things like Hive, treat Hive tables, which are often used as sort of beginning places for working with the data and experimenting with the data. Why not use those as a baseline and be able to pull those into this environment and work with the data at scale? And moreover, why not interact directly with HDFS? Why not be able to use it as an archiving destination? So I have a very large table, it's a petabyte. People only ever use the most recent 2 months, so maybe put the rest of it on a low-cost file system on HDFS. Why not be able to query those files directly from HDFS and use them for ingest? This way I avoid network hops, I avoid all the onerous stuff that goes with pulling it, dropping it somewhere else, running ETL tools, setting up an ETL farm, and so on. It's also about productivity. You know, there are a lot of ways that we measure productivity. One that we use at the Big Data Group is, how complete is it? It's one thing to parse a query, that's often first year of computer science, that's a project. It's another thing to run it well. So we use various proxies for assessing completeness and how well we support completeness. One of those is a benchmark called TPCDS. For those of you who don't know, TPCDS has a standard model, a standard set of queries, and a standard data generator. This is very useful as a rough baseline for determining not only does it run, but does it run well at scale. So we've tested this at scale with lots of data, and it runs all the queries very effectively. This is one proxy. The other thing, and this dovetails with it, is ANSI SQL. So we have ANSI SQL support. This means that your analyst can sit down, somebody who's been working with SQL their whole career, you don't need to send them to a Java class, they can be productive immediately. And, of course, there's JDBC and ODBC, so standard drivers so you can get at the data. You don't learn to value these things until you try doing something with an ODBC driver that's not mature and it breaks halfway through your process. There's something we built into Haven for Hadoop that based on the Vertica analytic database technology called the Database Designer. I convinced our product management, I'm really, thank you guys for doing this, to bring this over with Haven for Hadoop. This tool, as far as I'm aware, is unique. This lets you take your queries, it lets you take your data, you give it one or two goals, make it go fast, maybe compress it, you run it, it applies a set of heuristics, runs some tests, and gives you recommended ways to optimize performance in this environment. In this way, what you do is you take someone with a minimum amount of training and you make them as effective as the engineer who wrote the database designer. And we have some of the best and brightest database engineers in the world working on these technologies. But also, it's co-located on Hadoop. So if you just set up a 1,000-node cluster, and maybe the cluster is only 50% utilized most of the time, why not reuse those nodes? Why not be able to repurpose those nodes and run these processes on there? And again, a little less glamorous, but when you don't have it, you learn to love it, and that's standard BI and ETL tools. You know, what we did here was we leveraged the Vertica analytic database technology for the core engine of Haven on Hadoop. That means that all the maturity that comes from 10 years of us working on this product and building this out, putting in the leaders quadrant for Gartner data warehousing, all these things have been ported over. Your tools will work with it. Performance. We don't lead with performance. Vertica is well known to be one of the faster, more scalable databases out there, but things run fast. I won't talk about that too much at length. I'll be over at the booth later. We can talk more about it. But we continue to push the envelope. So you will be able to take things, and you will see things like 10x, 100x, 1000x, 10,000x speedups, and so on. We continue to push that envelope. We're distribution agnostic, so we don't care which flavor of Hadoop, although we tend to gravitate more towards the Apache core because that's where most of the momentum is. There's one thing I want to take a moment and talk about, a mature optimizer. The reason is because there's a lot of SQL on Hadoop today. For those of you who don't know, there's a big difference between parsing a query and generating a simple rule-based plan, if this, then that, and running it based on dynamic information collected from a distributed system at runtime and calculating an optimized plan for that. We've been at it for 10 years. The optimizer that's in this technology is the same optimizer that's in the Vertica analytic database. It's proven, and it's proven at scale. We have a few companies that have a little bit of data, like Facebook, who use this technology today. The third thing, and this is where we start to see a lot of transition into less sexy topics. You know, as startup people, I've been with a number of startups, we like to talk about things like it goes fast, it's flashy, it's transformational, but at the end of the day, for a business to use it, for them to make this the crown jewel of their information infrastructure, it has to be enterprise ready. That means things like a management console. So I can look at this, I can have one place where I can manage all this information and this complex infrastructure. It also needs to be able to deal with diverse workloads. You know, I've seen various implementations of different workload managers over the years. It's important to have in any distributed system because of the nature of the system. Little things that people don't think about often, like transactional consistency. Transactional consistency basically means if two people run the same query or same report at the same time, they get the same answer. This doesn't seem like much, and if we're querying machine logs, it may not matter. But I have sat in conference rooms where the financial analyst team comes in with one report, the CFO comes in with the exact same report, they ran at the exact same time, and they have two different answers on company financials. This is not a desirable thing. We don't want this. Active storage management. So we solve things like managing the underlying files on the file system. We optimize them, we compress them, we store them. Again, it's not something you think about until your DBAs have to transition from managing an environment that does that to one that doesn't. And suddenly you've got to have Puppet scripts and Hive and Perl and Java and you name it everywhere to start to cope with that complexity. Governance. We hear more and more about governance every day. Because I'm putting all this data in the Hadoop environment, I need to know what's there. I need to be able to characterize, does this file contain PII or not? Does it contain credit card information? Does it contain social security numbers? What's in here? Where is it? Who put it in here? When did they put it in? So all this governance is a big product theme for us, and being able to secure this information once it's in there. Fairly vanilla things that we're all used to in the database world, like Creative View, role-based security, obfuscate data so people can't read it if they shouldn't read it, and so on. These things add up to a set of robustness and enterprise-ready features that are often deal-breakers in data lakes. And finally, I don't know whether the Hortonworks dev team is here, but we do joint development with Hortonworks. So most of our work in the last 2 years with development and Hadoop and porting things to Hadoop has been driven by a lot of collaboration with the team, and I really want to thank the Hortonworks team for being so transparent and working so closely with us. So let me step back from Haven for Hadoop and talk about Haven generally. HP has built a platform called Haven. It's a big data platform. The idea, the concept, is to give an enterprise the tools and technology to deal with 100% of their information. Not half, not a quarter, not 10%, all of it. That means everything from your traditional stuff, CRM, ERP, and so on, through to machine logs and semi-structured data from instrumented infrastructures, all the way to human information, blogs, audio, video, audio from your call center, video from your stores, clickstream, you name it. The idea is one place, consistent set of back-end technologies, consistent set of APIs for development and data engineering, as well as deployment and consumption of technology. We're going big on this. The idea is, we're going to be the platform to enable an enterprise to become data-driven. There are three flavors of this today. One is Haven Enterprise, traditional on-prem database technology, on-prem technology. Haven on Hadoop, that I've just spent some time talking about. And then for people who are into cloud, Haven on Demand. So a lot of organizations tell me, I don't own any infrastructure, I don't want to own any infrastructure. And for those people, we have built this. We also have a lot of conventional enterprise customers for whom sandboxes are relevant. So all the same goodness, all the same technology you see in Haven on-prem, Haven on Hadoop, we're actively porting to Haven on Demand. So if you want to know more, when you're done, walk out, turn left, walk down that hall, and about 50 yards down is the HP booth. My colleagues will be there. I'll be there on and off throughout the day. Some of our best and brightest are there right now. Happy to answer your questions about this. Also, in August, we're hosting an event called the Big Data Conference. It's the Big Data Group in Boston. It's a couple of days in early August. It sells out every year. We expect about 5,000 this year. This is not us talking. This is our customers talking. You'll get to hear about people pushing the envelope, finding unique value, and experimenting with new ways of trying out these technologies. So I would urge you to ask and learn more about this and register for the event. It sells out every year. So enjoy the show, and thank you.
Thank you, Walt. Thank you very much.
Sure.
Appreciate it.
Yep.
Thanks for taking everybody through, right, the journey to a data lake, yep, right, and what you can do with HP to help them.
So happy to do it.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
So what I'd like to do now is switch to our last session of the keynotes for the morning. So in this one, this will be a fun one. So we've got David Epstein who's going to come up. He's going to walk through some analogies around sports and big data and what that means. He wrote a book, 2013 or so, bestseller on the New York Times list called The Sports Gene, and went through how do you leverage data and what can you do with that in sports and how do you find that edge. And if you think about sports, it's where people are constantly trying to figure out how do I get that little edge that makes a difference as an individual, as a team. And he looked at a lot of different data, you know, around training and other things, but also as you look at things like body types and the human shape and what that means and how it's better suited for different sports and how that works. So I think it'd be a really interesting conversation about the application of big data and what you can do with that. So David, come on out. Thank you.
Hey, thank you.
Welcome.
Very much.
Here
thank
you, go.
You. Thank you very much. So I'd like to start by talking about the importance of small advantages in a globally competitive industry, of which sports very much is. And to do that, I'd like you to imagine the last world championships of the 100-meter race. It was held in Luzhniki Stadium in Moscow, and it was packed with 80,000 fans because the fastest man in history, the Usain Bolt, the Jamaican sprinter, was there competing, and everybody wanted to see him. So try to imagine this stadium, right? Flashbulbs popping all around the stadium as the 9 fastest men in the world coil themselves into their starting blocks. And now, humor me for a second, and just close your eyes for a second, and I'll narrate the race. It'll be cool if everybody does it. Ready? Bang, the starter's gun goes off. An American sprinter jumps out to the front. Usain Bolt starts to catch him. Usain Bolt passes him, and as the runners come to the finish line, you'll hear a beep as each man crosses the line. Okay, you can open your eyes now. That's the entire finish of the race. Usain Bolt was that first beep. Raise your hand if you have any idea who that second beep was. Not one. That second beep is a guy who is 0.5% back and is anonymous in his home country. So that's the difference between an athlete who's worth $100 million and a guy who's anonymous in his home country. And it wasn't always this way in sports. As competition has gotten more global, the difference between a good and a great performer has squeezed way down to less than 1%. That guy in the fourth beep, the difference between third and fourth, that guy had to have an off-season job. The difference between the third and fourth beep, that guy in fourth was 1% back, is the difference between being able to be a full-time pro and not. And this is what's happened in a lot of industries as they've gotten globally competitive. The difference between good and great is often less than 1%. Listen to that again. See if you can differentiate beep number 3 from 4, because that's the important difference right there. That's it. That 9th guy, well, I mean, he can't even be a professional so far back. So how do we get those little advantages? Right, where do we find those? Anybody want to be really brave and guess what these 3 things have in common? Champagne, razor blades, and diapers? I probably wouldn't. What these 3 things have in common is that if you buy these 3 things, and only these 3 things, in a lot of convenience stores in the United States, you'll get flagged for credit card fraud on your way out. This turns out to be the most common purchase pattern of identity thieves who do actual land-based work. So apparently, champagne and razor blades are really easy to flip on the black market, and identity thieves buy diapers because it makes them seem non-threatening when they go to checkout. This was discovered by a man named Vivek Ranadive, actually by his company. It's a classic low-hanging fruit big data success, right? Cross-referencing huge amounts of confirmed identity theft and credit card purchases. Classic success, just taking something that wasn't available in the past and mining it. Vivek likes to say math is more important than science now. So it doesn't even have to understand what people do. The answer just presents itself if you have enough data. And so Vivek got pretty good at this. So he bought himself a congratulatory present, the Sacramento Kings of the NBA. And like a lot of tech entrepreneurs, he's moved into sports ownership. In fact, people who made their fortunes in big data are moving into sports management very, very quickly, and it's starting to change things. there's data available that's never been available before, and I want to give you an example of some of the ways that that's being used, and I want to use a relevant example. If people might have watched an NBA Finals game last night, saw LeBron James lead the Cavs to a victory, I want to show you LeBron James from last year's Finals. I'm going to show you a clip where his team's down 3 points. They need to score 3 points in the waning seconds or else the season's over and they lose the championship. Let's take a look.
Should the Spurs foul? Should Miami go for the three right away? Just attack the basket. James catches.
Okay, let's freeze it there for a second and look inside. So there you have, I know the tension's killing you. There you have the best player in the world about to take the last shot. This is analysis from a company called Second Spectrum. Now every single NBA arena has complete player tracking data. And so based on all of LeBron's shots, analysis of all of his shots, we can see that he's most likely kind of a medium arc shooter. If he misses, his ball is most likely to land in front of the rim and a little bit to the right, right? Based on analysis of all his shots. And you can see those kind of purple sections. Some of this data is starting to be used to help defenders figure out how to best guard a certain section of space, a certain shape. All of this stuff has just been coaches' intuition for the last 100 years. It turns out some of their intuition's actually wrong. So in this picture, you see Chris Bosh, the best rebounder on the Miami Heat, is not in very good position. And he has a rebound probability of 2% from that spot. So let's take a look and see what actually happens.
James catches, puts up a three. Won't go. Rebound Bosh. Back out to Allen. His three-pointer. Bang! Tie game with 5 seconds remaining.
So Chris Bosh drops down to the exact spot where the analytics say LeBron James' shot will go if he misses. Throws it to Ray Allen in the corner, which the analytics show is Ray Allen's highest percentage shot. And they keep the season going. They lost in the next game anyway, so they lost. But so this kind of data, there's been a lot of low-hanging fruit with it in sports, right? Like, we know the corner three-pointer is, even if you miss it more often than a two-pointer, decent shooters hit it enough that they should basically always take it when they have an open look. But for the most part, the way this has been used is to help fans enjoy the game, give them x-ray vision into what's happening in the game. And in some cases, teams are starting to talk about opening up the Jumbotron to fans who can then do analytics in real time while the game's going on. So really interesting applications here. In Australia, Aussie Rules football teams are starting contests where they'll actually just give their data away. And this is pretty unprecedented in sports because even when it doesn't make a difference, people like to hoard their data for competitive advantage. They're allowing fans to start trying to produce analytics that make a difference. And they'll give people like a season ticket if they can produce something that makes a difference. But for the most part, outside of the low-hanging fruit, data hasn't actually made a huge difference in sports. Sports are drowning in data, applying most of it to startlingly little effect. And I think that's because the big data needs to go with something that I call small data. And I want to give you a sense of what that is, because I think there are a lot of opportunities there for people like you to revolutionize some of the things that are going on in sports. And to talk about small data, I want to use an example from UK sports. When they were awarded the last Summer Olympics in 2012, they decided science and medicine was going to be their advantage. And the first thing they did was started sort of a semi-big data program. They called the Determinants of Performance. It was just going to look at data, usually video data, and figure out what variables matter to performance in every sport. Amazing that nobody really knows that, right? So they started with the most simple sports. The most simple sport they could think of, shot put. Super simple sport. 3 variables that determine the outcome, essentially. The height of release of the shot, the velocity of release of the shot, and the angle of release of the shot. That's basically the whole shebang, right? That's some people's life's work right there. And so they looked at a competition between the two best guys in the world to see how those variables played out. The guy who got the silver medal actually had a higher release height because he's tall. The guy who got the silver had a better release velocity, which is the most difficult. That means he's probably a better athlete, a better, more explosive athlete. That's the most difficult part to coach. Actually, being tall is also difficult to coach. But the guy who got the gold threw 1.5 degree higher angle and won the gold medal. 1.5 degree. All he had was a better angle. So they said, well, what if that guy who got silver had thrown 1 degree higher himself? 1 degree higher. Not at the perfect angle, just 1 degree higher. Then he would have thrown slightly longer and he would have won the gold medal by 1 centimeter. That's it, just by throwing 1 degree higher. So they said, you know what? Let's look at other sports, starting with the simple ones, and look at their determinants of performance. They started with long jump. 3 determinants of performance. Speed down the runway, the force you put into the jumping board, and the angle of the jump, period. So they hired a PhD biomechanist, of which there are precious few in the world, gave her the title Horizontal Jumps Specialist. Pretty specialized role there. And her job was just to see which of these 3 variables she could do something about. They knew they all really mattered. They knew they all really mattered, and they usually spent time working on force into the board, but she figured out really quickly That was really hard to change. She couldn't change sprint speed at all at that point. She couldn't change force into the board because everyone has pretty good technique. Force into the board is, technique is the thing that most of the people at that level spend all their time working on. What she did find was that she could change angle very easily, and people never work on angle. It seems like something silly, right? Like you have to think about jumping at a certain angle. So she worked with Great Britain's best jumper for 2 years, nothing but jumping angle. Come the Olympics, he doesn't have one of the 10 fastest approaches into the board, doesn't have one of the 5 highest forces into the board, jumps at the perfect angle and wins the gold medal. So here's a guy who probably isn't one of the 10 best athletes in the world in his sport. But by taking from the big data, figuring out what mattered, but then drilling down to what they could actually do something about, to what they could change, adding a little science to that, they found how to give him that extra 0.5%. That's what I call small data, taking from the big data, but it isn't always, the answers don't always pop out like credit card fraud. I think there are huge opportunities in human performance to add it to just a little bit of science to figure out what is changeable to help people quickly, more quickly become experts than they have in the past. And I think to talk a little bit about how this might work in expertise, I want to talk a little bit about what science has learned quite recently about the difference between expert athletes and novices. And to do that, I want to start with just a little video clip here of a guy, an amateur soccer player named Ronald, trying to do a pretty hard task. It's actually a recreation of a famous sports science study.
Dark! Light! Light!
So what does the night vision reveal? Ronald misses the ball by quite a way. Perhaps not that surprising.
Right, not that surprising that when the lights are turned off, the guy can't put his head on the flying ball. So I think it's not that surprising. But let's see how a slightly better soccer player does, someone you might have heard of, Cristiano Ronaldo. Same task, a little bit better.
Dark! Light!
All right, that's one straight in the bag.
The night vision replay shows how differently Ronaldo performs.
So that's not about strength or speed. It's about information processing. It's about what sports scientists call chunking. Cristiano Ronaldo, actually, they could run this all the way back until he could just see the ball just struck and could still connect with it. The way that elite athletes are able to do what they do to look like they have superhuman reaction speed is because they pick up on body cues from the person they're reacting to, rotations of the shoulders and torso, shifts of the lower leg, rotation of the ball, and so they see the future, where the ball is going before it gets there. It turns out this kind of information processing is the hallmark of expertise, and we've learned a lot about it but with gaze tracking technology in athletes. In baseball, it's amazing. The minimum human reaction time is barely better than the entire time of a baseball flight pitch. And you know, if any of you have kids, you've told them to keep their eye on the ball in Little League. We actually don't have a visual system capable of tracking an object that's angular position is moving that fast. It gets close to our head. So that advice to keep your eye on the ball is total nonsense. You literally cannot do it. You could close your eyes once the ball was halfway and it wouldn't make any difference. That's why if anybody's ever seen a softball pitcher go up against the best major league hitters, the major league hitters can't hit them because the body cues are totally different. The information processing that they have, and they don't know why they can't do this, right? It goes to one of my favorite sports writing sayings, just because you're a bird doesn't mean you're an ornithologist. When they send all these guys up against a softball pitcher and they all say, oh, I'm gonna hit this girl. Nobody does. It became a TV show, actually, that the guys did so bad. So I wanna give you a little information processing task, and I picked something that I assume none of you are expert in so that you won't actually know the visual cues. Maybe somebody is, but probably no handball experts. Tried to pick something obscure. So I'm gonna give you, you're gonna play digital goalkeeper, and I'm gonna give you a little simulation. Tell me where this ball is going that this woman's trying to throw past you. It's called an occlusion test. Raise your hand for upper right. Lower right. Lower left. Upper left. It's actually lower left. It's a really hard task because of how quickly it's cut off, except for 100% of elite handball players get it right because of their information processing. And we're just starting to learn how this sort of thing works. Things that looked like they were about speed or reflexes actually are all about information processing, especially in sports with really short reaction time limits, like boxing. Muhammad Ali could execute a jab from first perceptible movement to full extension in 150 milliseconds. If I turned on a light bulb and had you hit a button as quickly as you could, you wouldn't get faster than 200 milliseconds. So if his competitors weren't anticipating based on his body movements, they'd be hit flush by every punch. Obviously, his ability to disguise those body movements meant they often were anyway. Take a look at how this works. Watch this punch. You can't tell me this guy doesn't see this coming, right? Right directly in his line of sight there. But we're limited by our reaction speed. Oh, you thought that was funny. Watch this next one's coming all the way from Alabama here. This next one takes a punch about as long as a punch could possibly take. Directly in this guy's line of sight for about as long as a punch could possibly take. Can't even begin to flinch. He goes down so fast, this next guy's anticipatory skills fail him. He swings way over his head. So, I'll save you the drama. He's going down like a ton of bricks. So the reason you, well, most of you couldn't get that handball test right is because you haven't learned the right kind of information processing to predict the future. You haven't learned your chunking. You haven't put in the time to learn it. But you do use chunking in other things in which you're expert. So I want to give you a little chunking test. You're able to pull information quickly from things in which you're expert. If you're listening to me, you're an expert enough in the English language. So I'm going to give you a slide with 20 English words. I'm going to give you 10 seconds. I want you to memorize as many as you can. Ready? Go. Get all those? 5, 10, 12, you're some kind of mnemonic device expert. Okay, now you had a practice run. I'm going to give you 10 more seconds, 20 English words. I want you to try again. See how many you can memorize. Ready, set, go. Did you do better that time? If not, there's something wrong with you. Or you don't speak English. As you might have guessed, those are the same 20 English words or the same 20 pieces of data. But you've learned a system of grammar and groups and chunks of phrases and words that allow you to quickly extract meaning from 20 otherwise chaotic pieces of data. And if we were able to track your eyes, you'd see going to certain spots in the middle of phrases that let you quickly learn what's going on. This is like a famous study in the 1940s that gave chess players of different ability levels boards and then took them away and asked them to recreate them. Grandmaster chess players could recreate an entire board after seeing it for 3 seconds. That's a hard task. And so the researchers concluded they have photographic memory. But then the study was repeated more recently, and in this case a wrinkle was added. The players were also given boards that would never quite occur in a game situation. And in that case, the grandmasters were no better than the novices. They didn't have photographic memory, they had just learned to process the information differently. And now, for the first time ever, we're starting to use huge data collection, big data, gaze tracking from expert athletes, combine it with a little bit about what we know of the science, to be able to start teaching people skills that only experts have much quicker, things that they had to learn implicitly over years. Here's a good example of that. Turns out that once gaze tracking, digital collection of where the eyes are moving, became available, in any targeting task, something called quiet eye, a period where the eye goes still right before the task is done, turns out to be really important for accuracy. So, this is a simulation using the aggregate data. I'll show you what a professional golfer's eye does in the 2 seconds before they putt. It goes like this. One, two, and then they putt. That's it. Now, let me show you the simulation based on the aggregate data from lesser players. These are very good amateurs in the 2 seconds before they putt. It goes like this. Six different spots in the same time. Now, obviously, that's slightly larger than real life ball. So these are micro movements, tiny movements of the eye. It turns out these are changeable. This is changeable. There's a small data component to it. In fact, if you tell the amateurs to stop doing that, stop moving their eye around, they say, what are you talking about? I wasn't moving my eye around. These are tiny movements. But then if you do something like put a word under the ball, tell them to try to read it and not lift their head until they've read it. After they putt, in 2 weeks, they take about 1.8 strokes off a round, and these are good amateur golfers. That's something, that quiet eye period is something that's learned implicitly by elites over years that we've now had success with in teaching in a few weeks. So it's speeding up expertise development, but it's one of the very few successes. Sports is drowning in data, but the bottleneck is people to analyze it. People to analyze it, so all we're getting is the low-hanging fruit, stuff that's more fun for the fans to see inside of the game, as opposed to stuff like this, where we can actually speed up people's skill development. There are other applications that people are trying to start to use, because now we know something about the pattern of eye movements and information processing in anyone working in targeting skills. So some of it's starting to be applied to basketball, because we know what the right pattern is, And so now you can actually give people the real-time feedback to try to follow that right pattern. So here's a girl who was having some shooting problems, and they decided that she was cocking her head to the side when she was shooting. They learned that from the eye tracking, and so here she goes, and now she's doing quite well. So there are huge opportunities here, but some of this won't come only out of the big data. The problem will come out of the big data. Then the solution needs a small data component. And there's so much opportunity in the sports world to pair with teams, to pair with coaches, high-performance science labs, to apply some of these data skills that people like you have that aren't being applied at all, aren't being applied in any good way. And this is obviously, I've been talking kind of about high-level competitive sports, but most people aren't high-level competitive athletes. In fact, most people probably aren't as athletic as they'd like to be anytime. But there's applications coming around for normal athletes, weekend warriors as well. Here's a photo from a company called RunScribe. RunScribe took advantage of shrinking accelerometers. And I was able to pilot test some of this. Hooking up tiny accelerometers to the shoe, taking real-time data people can get on their phone. You ever gone to a shoe store and somebody tells you something about, like, your foot and what kind of shoe you should wear? You've probably had that experience. Completely folklore. We actually know nothing about that. There's no science about it, because we don't have enough science of the biomechanics. Every time a study is done, somebody's measuring one parameter, or they're doing it in a lab. RunScribe is now equipping runners with these. They're just in pilot phase, getting braking forces, getting movements of the bones and the joints, and collecting more data on running biomechanics in a couple weeks than we've been able to collect in the last 50 years. And it's crowdsourced. They're giving people access to some of the crowdsourced data. You can do real-time analysis, look at your forces using different shoes. So for the first time ever, we can do what seems like the simple thing of giving someone a shoe that actually decreases their ground forces when they run. You've all been sold stuff like that before, but now we can actually do it. And this is part of individualizing our experience, right? That's what digitalization does, whether it's Facebook or Airbnb. It allows us to individualize our environment, what's best for us, or the music we like to listen to, whatever it is. And we're finally starting to see this in training human performance. In fact, I sometimes do some little pilot studies on myself, because I think there's an ultimate frontier that's going to materialize in the next decade, and we need some good people to get involved. And I want to use my own story a little bit to talk a little bit about what that is. That's me. When I was in college, lower to upper body weight ratio was a little bit better than it is now, and a lot more hair. I was a walk-on runner. It means I wasn't good enough to be recruited. I was running the 800 meters, half mile. This is the guy who I was paired with, my training partner named Scott. You can see him wearing his Canadian kit because he was already so good, he was a member of the Canadian national team. And they pair us together, you know, because there's this tradition of pairing the blue chip recruit with the walk-on so that the walk-on doesn't come back after week one, basically. And it works. It's really effective. Except for whatever reason, I stuck with it. Scott was 20 seconds faster than I was in the 800 meters when we were both in high school. That's a lot. It's two laps of a track. 20 seconds is like a different world. But I stuck with it, and kind of because I like my teammates. And interesting things started to happen. I couldn't do Scott's workload, so I would do sort of lesser multiples of what he did, and yet I started to gain on him. I was doing a different kind of work than I'd ever done before, this kind of sprint-based work, and I was gaining on him, gaining on him, gaining on him, and he was kind of stagnating. And at about a minute and 52 seconds in the 800 meters, which is actually pretty fast for a half mile, I passed him, and he never beat me again, and I kept getting faster, and he stagnated. So it was a really interesting experience because our coaches and teammates kind of gave us these interesting narratives where me, like, I was so tough, you know, no talent, walk on, so tough because you keep improving. I'm like, yeah, okay, that's cool. Scott was totally the opposite. He comes in with all the talent in the world, not improving at all, head case. Must be a head case. Wasn't a head case till he started getting a pep talk before every race. He was working harder than I was, so I knew something was kind of wrong was going on with those narratives. But I wasn't going to negate those because it led to all this cool stuff for me. Like, I won my university's award for the four-year athlete to achieve significant athletic success in the face of unusual challenge and difficulty. My unusual challenge and difficulty just being that I stunk at first. But I always felt like there was something wrong with this narrative. And when I was reporting my book, I kind of found out what. So these are results from the most famous exercise genetics study of all time called the Heritage Family Study. In this segment of the study, 98 two-generation families were put on about a half year of cycling training. These were all sedentary families, people who had never trained or really even exercised in any way. And the point of this section of the study was to see how much their aerobic capacity would improve. That's the amount of oxygen you can move through your bloodstream when you're working as hard as you can. It's a really important predictor of mortality and endurance. So it's important for performance, and it's really important for health. And here you can see the results, the improvements in oxygen carrying after 6 months, going from no training to training. People all the way on the left, kind of surprising. Some people after 6 months of training got a little bit worse, but very few people. Still kind of surprising. Some people way on the right got way better. Way better. Most people were kind of in the middle. Right? More recently, these researchers found a 21 gene predictor set. They basically looked at the protein production, how that differed between people, using classic big data techniques, and found a 21 gene predictor set from that that predicts who's going to improve with a given training plan before they even undertake it. All of these subjects did the exact same training. People who had at least 19 of the good versions of the genes improved the amount of oxygen they could move 3 times as much as people who had fewer than 10 on identical training. Identical training. The same kind of pattern held for every health parameter they looked at, cholesterol profiles, pulse rate, blood pressure, and identical training. So they could say, the American College of Sports Medicine has this phrase now, exercise is medicine. It's because of stuff like this. You know, what we've learned from medical genetics is, I might need 3 Tylenol. Well, you only need 1 because of differences in our genes that metabolize acetaminophen. Turns out the same thing is true of the medicine of training. We can start to tell the kind of effects that anyone's going to get from a particular training plan. And also, interestingly, from this study, the relationship, the correlation between ability at baseline to move oxygen and ability to be trained was 0. So on the first day of the study, the scientists said, here are our 10 most talented people. Missed 100% of the people who ended the study looking the most talented. How different of a notion of talent is that than what we're used to? These kind of analysis techniques, applying big data to gene expression, seeing how the action of genes differs when people are given a certain stimulus, is totally redefining what we think of as talent. Trainability is a more important kind of talent. And it's holding across a variety of skills. And in some cases, it can be applied to say, well, someone needs to drop their blood pressure. We know if they can get that with really easy exercise or they need to be medicated, right? And you can start to see people who might not try something because they look like they're bad. I was the classic low baseline, high responder, terrible at rest, get like winded walking up the stairs. Had almost all those genes. Right? I was so bad when I started out being competitive that I got a pulmonologist examination, said I was consistent with the earliest stages of emphysema. That was 2 years before I ran at the US National Championships. 2 years. I assume most people like that quit because we haven't known anything about how they work. There's some direct-to-consumer genetics companies that are starting to try to take certain big data approaches, but it's not really working very well because they're looking at single genes. And it turns out single genes almost always have tiny effects. So we need to look at huge networks of genes. I was just at NIH last week getting a tour of their sequencing lab, and they're really proud that they can sequence a whole genome now in 4 days, not 6 years, and it's about to be 3 days with some new equipment that Illumina is making, a whole genome in 3 days. The first time took 6 years. But they have a bottleneck at the data analysis. They're bragging about how quickly they can sequence, but they're so far behind in being able to analyze it. They need help. That's where the bottleneck is. So I've got this wonderful resource, right? If anyone's followed the Human Genome Project, you know it's kind of been disappointing. It was amazing that we did it, but the results coming out of it haven't really changed the way that healthcare and exercise are applied, because they're so far behind the actual data, focused on sequencing. There's so much opportunity there to revolutionize healthcare, to do what we've done for music or social interaction, allowing people to personalize their environment, to do this for actually taking control of their health or athletic development. Right? I'm kind of a weirdo, so I've done all kinds of personalized stuff. When I started getting good, I decided to learn a lot of things about myself and personalize my training as much as I could. So actually, here's a sample of the cells in my leg. Had a sample of my muscle taken out. And it turns out that I have a lot more of a certain kind of muscle fiber than others, so I had to change my training accordingly. And when I started learning about this, I was going through all this decades, 100 years of research on muscle fiber type. And it's so scattered. There's a ton of data, but it's not put together in any useful way, so it took me a year to figure out what I should be doing. It's out there already. And instead of analyzing the data, people are doing more studies. We don't even need more studies on this. We need someone to put the data together and revolutionize the way athletes are trained, or just normal people. So I think if we take this approach of learning what things matter for personal health, for training, for sports performance and competition, we take that big data approach, figuring out the things that matter, get all the low-hanging fruit, shoot the corner three-pointer, right? That are the things that will pop out. The math is more important than science now. But then applying it to things that we know are actually changeable for people, the small data, working with scientists or figuring out the things that we can actually allow people to do something about so they can become experts more quickly or become healthy more quickly. Then we can bring that personalized environment to everyone in a way that really isn't being done at all right now. Focusing on consumer goods, which is wonderful, but this is totally being left alone. It's an area where we can really have a revolution. I think we can start to get to the dream of J.M. Tanner, who's a guy I love. J.M. Tanner was the world's expert in body growth and development, and he was also a world-class athlete. Everyone has a different genotype. Therefore, for optimal development, everyone should have a different environment. Now, I like that quote because it's about genes, but really it could be about anything. Everyone has different experiences. Everyone has different resources. Therefore, for optimal development, everyone should have a different environment. What we're learning about physiology is how truly different people are from one another. And across the consumer world, we're allowing people to personalize the things they do. But there's very, very little attention being paid in an area that has a lot of interest, a lot of commercial potential. There's a lot of money in exercise. There's a lot of money to be had in people who can stem the tide of chronic disease in the United States. Right? Like smokers weren't as bad for healthcare because they die pretty quickly. Now we have people who have metabolic syndrome and they live for 50 years and are just really expensive. In all those areas, to the point where we have enough genetic data right now, even if we weren't gathering any more, we could be doing things that would affect billions of people literally in the way they train and take care of themselves. And it's communities like this. The bottleneck is before people like you. We don't even need to be doing any more science right now. We need more people who can analyze it. So there are tremendous opportunities there. From the highest level of sports to just people getting healthier. And I hope that people here will apply some of the magic they've applied in other industries, because it's amazing, to this industry that's being completely overlooked because it doesn't have enough people paying attention. Especially if you're a sports fan, there could be some opportunities to work alongside some of the people that you watch on television, which is also a lot of fun. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David.
Thank you.
That's fascinating. I'm going to go out and get that book, The Sports Gene. I think that was fascinating. So just thinking about all the data and what you can go do with it. You know, we talked about, you know, the bike ride this morning, and you think about it. You had companies like Garmin and Timex and others who have all this data on a person and what they can go track, and everyone looked at it as individual. And then you had other companies like Strava and others who would go take that and say, let me apply that against everyone else in the room, and suddenly everyone else is pushing them harder because of the competitive nature. I know John Wilson said this on the first day. He said, you know, you think about IoT and what we talk about. Well, the human is probably the most complicated machine out there. And what can you do with all that data, and how do you go leverage it? Either improve the individual, in this case, improve an individual in sports, right, and what they can do just by tracking the data, which may not be necessary to be more training, but how do you go apply that training the right way? It's a fascinating topic in terms of what you can do with all that data. So we're at the conclusion of our day for today. So I want to give you one quick thing on tomorrow, because this is being important, because I know everybody here is going to go have a phenomenal time at the party and lose track of time. I want to let you know, tomorrow morning when we do this, some really interesting sessions. You know, one, we do have Jeffrey Moore, who's coming up and going to be talking about how does he look at this market and how does he compare it to others in crossing the chasm, and what does it mean and what are the implications for that? Fascinating conversation in terms of what that means from the expert around what market cycles look like. Second is, the other highlight, this is typically a highlight of the keynotes, is we're going to have a customer panel. So five different customers sitting up here and talking. And it's Rogers, it's Schlumberger, it's Symantec, it's Verizon, it's Home Depot, right? All sitting up here and sharing their experiences of what is it like when they first started with Hadoop? What would they do differently if they could start over? How do they think about that from a deployment? What problems are they solving with it? And where else are they going to go apply the technology inside of their environments? And it's always, I think, a favorite of the group to go hear what are all these companies doing? How do they think about this, and what's the opportunity that they're trying to leverage with big data, either as they think of it to transform their businesses, how pervasive it is, or what they're trying to do across the enterprise. So with that, everyone's on to a break. Thank you very much. We'll see you all at the party tonight in San Pedro Square, and we'll see everyone tomorrow. Thank you.